So, David, we're ready to start.
Okay, I'm ready.
I think it's time, and most of the students, please introduce yourself and go ahead.
Just a quick question. Do we have online visitors as well, or just you in the room?
Sorry, say again.
Do we have spectators online, or you are just inside the room?
All the students are in one room and we have only one connected online.
Ah, okay, thank you. So may I start?
Yes.
Okay then, good morning and welcome everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to share my thoughts on electrical car design or informal student. And thanks for the opportunity for Andrei especially. Who I am, maybe you don't know me. I'm David Kish. I'm the chairman of Former Student East, and I have experience with for electrical former student cars since 2011. In 2011, I was one of the few guys who built the first electrical car in the history of Budapest University of Technology and Economics. So surely I know the challenges you face when you have to build an electrical car first time. After that, I joined the organizational crew of the Hungarian Former Student event. I was electrical scrutineer. Later on, I became electrical scrutineering leader. After that, I was technical leader. So I was responsible for all the scrutineering and the technical documentation. And well, right now I become the chairman of the event. But at our event, for everyone, it's basically just a hobby. So in my main time, I am an e-mobility product owner at Knorr-Bremse Brake Systems. And I'm also working on my PhD and trying to finish it in the next few years in the field of e-mobility and electrical drives. If you have any questions later on, you can contact me at david.kiss@fses.eu, or hopefully you can catch me on the next Former Student East event. What we are going to see today, first, and just a quick system overview, how an electrical car builds up, and after that I'm going to emphasize a few critical parts which you need to pay attention more carefully. And after that we can have a discussion about how shall you plan your season to develop an electrical car. By the way, if you have any questions during the presentation, please feel free to interrupt me and ask something, and keep that interactive as much as possible. So, what are the main differences between an electrical and a combustion engine car? Is an electrical faster? Well, I'm not sure. So it depends on you, how you are designing it, how you are going to make it work. But yes, if you design a good electric car, it can beat a combustion engine car for sure. Is it simpler? Well, not at all. To be honest, an electrical car contains system-wise many more components, but if you are designing it right, the reliability can be much more better than a combustion engine car because it has less moving parts, the efficiency is better, you have other kind of thermal issues, and you have other kind of hazards than in a combustion engine car. For example, you don't have to take care of flammable fuel, but you have to watch for your batteries to keep it inside the safe operation area. Is an electrical car lighter? Well, we have seen light electrical cars and heavy electrical cars, and we have seen light combustion engine cars and heavy combustion engine cars as well. So it also boils down how you are going to design the car. What I'm trying to say with that is basically the drivetrain is not superior for other kind of drivetrains, and you have to pay attention to create a car which is great on system level. So you have to design the drive system with your chassis, with your aero, with your suspension and everything else together to make the whole package working. Dangerous? Yes, an electrical car is very, very dangerous, especially because the dangers are invisible. So obviously there are risk of electrical shock because you are dealing with high voltage systems, like at maximum 600 volts. And the real problem is that it's DC voltage, and the DC current shock is much more dangerous than AC. So we have to be very, very careful, not just with the battery, but with the electrical motors and the inverter as well, because the inverter usually has bulk DC capacitors, which are storing energy for smooth operation. And these capacitors are not discharging immediately if you are disconnect or switch off your system. So you have to keep bear attention that everything is disenergize and discharge before you do any maintenance with the high voltage part. Also, other danger is not the voltage reason, but because of the lithium ion batteries. So lithium ion batteries are really, really sensitive, and usually in a former student car, you want to use the batteries on the edge of the capabilities, and this edge is very, very thin. So your battery management system has to be always spot on, and you have to be always be careful not to overstress or over-discharge or overcharge the batteries or overheat, for example. So there is a lot of parameters you need to be checked. And the real danger with the batteries, that if you are discharged lithium-ion batteries too deep sometimes, then you are creating an invisible risk, because this kind of batteries can change internally. There are some spike building up in the insulation layer if you are deep discharge the batteries, and these deep discharge batteries can catch fire anytime after deep discharge. Can be 5 minutes, can be 1 second, can be 1.5 years. And this risk is always there if you are leaving the safe operation area. And believe me, if you see a lithium-ion battery on fire, you have to be run very, very, very far away. So keep attention on that. Also, is building an electrical car cheaper? Well, this is really an issue, because not. Only just the battery pack cost can eat up the whole cost of a combustion engine car if we are speaking about an easier or simpler setup. So you really have to be careful designing those parts, because even big teams struggling with collecting enough funds to build up a spare battery, for example. So cost-wise, an electrical car can be a challenge. Any questions so far?
No questions.
Okay. So what are your key factors to success if you are building an electrical car at the first time? I think you should set your expectations right. So if you never ever build an electrical former student car before, don't expect to win the whole season for the first time. It's a much, much more complicated system than a combustion engine car. So I think your first target shall be to build an electrical car which is passes scrutineering and able to finish the endurance. If you are managed to do so, I think you are a very successful team in the first year. How can you achieve that? How can you make sure that thing will happen? Well, you have to design the simplest package which are able to fulfill the rules, able to meet the safety requirements, and able to finish the end runs. It means that you don't have to go for any kind of extra, any kind of bells and whistles. You have to have basically an HV battery. I recommend you to get an off-the-shelf motor and inverter, and you have to design the rest of a former student car, basically. One really important message that most of the electrical teams are failing scrutineering, not because their car are not meeting the regulations, or they can't make a car which is able to meet the regulations. It's simply because on the scrutineering type, for example, can't turn on the HV system, can't show the battery management system is working, and so on. So it's mostly like mostly boils down to lack of functionality or lack of reliability instead of technical issues. So make sure you are aiming for the simplest electrical system, which is meeting the regulations, and test as much this simple system as you can, and make sure it checks every box in the scrutineering sheets. How can you achieve that? Well, you have to plan ahead your wall season, the design and everything. You have to have, in my opinion, at least two iteration with every self-made ECUs, because if you are designing an electrical circuit board or a printed circuit board and you are testing it for the first time, usually it will not work. Or if you are lucky, it will work, but you will discover some issues, some small changes when you can solder a small wire on a PCB or cut some tracks on the PCB and make it work. And for desktop tests, it's really okay. But if you are assembling something like this in your car, when you have jumper wires and parts like that floating above your PCB, it will fail for surely, because in a car, the electrical components in are a much rough environment, and you can imagine it, vibrations, heat changes, and so on. So these kind of quick fixes are usually falling off, tears apart, and things like that. So I really recommend to after the first test, if you discover any issues which need to be modified, remanufacture the PCBs and use electronics which are not having any quick and dirty solutions on it. After that, you have to design and manufacture a proper wiring harness. So I think in a first year team, that is usually teams forgetting that they need a wiring loom to connect everything together, and they are underestimating the complexity of these tasks. So the wiring harness will be one of the most complexity parts inside your system. So if you count the pin count of every connector in your electrical system, even if you're aiming for the most basic one, it will be well above 100 pins and connections. So you want to make sure this more than 100 cables are running properly. The system is easily repairable and exchangeable and manufacturable, because if you are putting these 100 cables, more than 100 cables inside your car without any concept, it will become a mess really, really soon. And if this system is not tidy or not clear, it will show off during scrutineering, it will make a bad feeling about your car. And later on in your season, you will have a lot of trouble with debugging if you discover any issue. After that, if you are designed everything and you can put together your car and it is able to move on its own, then you may test something or may test somebody, may test some parts of the car, but not that much, because your car is not ready yet. If your car is capable of moving, then I think you are around 20% on the success route, because your car not just have to be able to move on its own, but it has to pass scrutineering as well. And most teams are, I think, forgetting this, and they are very happy if their car are starting to work and they can test it and they can go with it and have fun on the test track and so on. And they are usually spending not that many time which is necessary to make sure their car are ready for scrutineering and ready for an event. So if you are assembled your system and everything is working, then congratulations, you build a working former student car. But disassemble it again and make sure that everything you assembled inside your car is according to the rules, and it will pass scrutineering. Because if you are able to pass scrutineering, then it's very likely that you will be successful in the event as well. After that, if you are ready to go for scrutineering, then you can test as much as you want and as much as you think it's necessary. Here is a picture with which you have to be really familiar if you are building an electrical car. This is from the former student rules 2020, and it is an example circuit of the safety circuit of your car. What is a safety circuit? The safety circuit makes sure that the HV battery is only switched on if everything in your car is in normal operating conditions. How it can do that? The safety circuit is basically the auxiliary supply of your accumulator installation relays. So if this circuit is closed, then the accumulator installation relays can be powered, and the accumulator voltage can be switched on, and it can be reachable outside from your accumulator. And I think we shall go over the parts. So at first you have your low voltage battery, because the low voltage battery will supply the power for the accumulator installation relays. It's very important that you have to fuse the low voltage battery as well. So you have to have some kind of current limiting device inside the circuit. After that, you are having your low voltage master switch. You have to be familiar with that from a combustion engine car as well. It's the same kind of red switch that has to be on the side of the car. After that, you can supply every other low voltage part of your system, but you have to go on with the safety circuit as well. The order here is not really important, because every switch is in series. So if one of the switch disconnects, the accumulator installation relays will be switched off as well. So the first device is the BSPD, which is the brake system plausibility device. What the brake system plausibility device does, actually, from 2019, you have to equip the combustion engine cars with a system like that as well. So what the brake system plausibility device do is it basically compares the brake pressure and the throttle position. And if your driver pushing too many, a really high amount of brake, and he or she is pushing the accelerator pedal as well, these devices are shutting off the high voltage system, making sure that your car actually can stop in a case of emergency, and your electrical motors are not working against your brakes. It's really important, because actually on former student East in 2018, we had an accident with a combustion engine car. And in that accident, what happened that the pedal box design was a bit poor. And when the driver pushed the brake pedal, the accelerator pedal stuck under the brake pedal. And when the driver braked hard, he also pushed full accelerator pedal position as well. And the result was the car overran the test track and end up nearby the road in the grass. So it was not a good experience for the team, and scary for us as well. But unfortunately, from 2019, the BSPD is mandatory for combustion engine cars as well, and it actually prevents situations like this from happening. Okay, the next part is the IMD, the installation monitoring device. This is one of the components which has to be an off-the-shelf product. It's actually recommended what kind of device you may use in your system. It's a Bender branded installation monitoring device. And what this thing does is measuring that your high voltage system is really floating and really insulated from your car. I haven't drawn that before, but when you're designing an electrical former student car, and usually every electrical car, the low voltage system is grounded, like it's symbolized here, but the high voltage system is floating. What that means that both the negative and the positive pole is insulated from the car's chassis, and it is necessary because if you are shorting the high voltage battery, then you are shorting a really high energy contact energy source, and it can cause fire very rapidly. And if you are not grounding any of the poles of the high voltage battery, it means that one installation failure in your car can't lead to any serious issue. It will lead to a dangerous situation, but it not lead to any serious issue. And this installation monitoring device is there to detect this one single issue and making sure that your driver is safe and your car will not catch on fire. So this installation monitoring device, as the name suggests, measures the installation resistance between the chassis and the poles of the accumulator. And if it finds any issue, then it's going to switch off your high voltage system. And this IMD issue is one of the issues which are not able to reset from the cockpits. You have to cycle the power of the ball car, so your driver can do that or cannot do that. And if you have an IMD issue during endurance, then surely you are old because your driver cannot reset the car with external help. Also, one of the key things with the IMD is the rain test. So I'm sure that you are aware that for electrical cars and scrutineering, we are doing a rain test as well. And we are usually testing the IMD prior the rain test and after the rain test as well. And it has to be working in both cases because by the whole point of the rain test is to test your car has proper insulation even when it's wet. And if the EMD is not working well, it's pretty easy to pass the rain test because there is no system to detect any kind of insulation failure. And also, at FSEs, at least we are usually test the IMD after the endurance as well, for the same reason, because it's easy to pass the endurance if your IMD cannot switch off the system. So make sure you are test your car with the IMD installed at all times because it keep you, your team and your driver safe always. The next really critical part is the EMS, the accumulator management system. It also can open the shutdown circuit and it shall open the shutdown circuit when it detects any of the measured battery parameters out of the safe operation area. It can be cell voltage, can be current, can be cell temperature and so on. And also, if you have an accumulator management issue, you also not be able to reset the car internally. So again, as like the IMD, you always want to test your battery and you always want to use your battery with the accumulator management system installed because it's really keep you safe and it really protects your battery from catching fire and degrading capacity and so on. Okay, the next three shall be familiar from the combustion engine car as well. You have to have a cockpit shutdown button from the driver and you have to have a left and the right shutdown button on your car. These are installed usually on the main hoop and they are there to make sure that you can switch off the car externally from any direction. The next two is for driverless cars only, so I'm going to skipping that at the moment. After that, there is the inertial switch. These inertial switch are switching off the high voltage system if you are above a certain G level, and it's usually only happening if you are hit something on the during the testing on the track. After that, there is the breakover travel switch. This is also familiar from combustion engine car. It basically switches off the high voltage system if your brake pressure is collapsing for any kind of system leak. Also, the next part is the HVD and the interlock. The HVD it stands for high voltage disconnect, and it is basically a blind connector which is removed, it breaks up the high voltage line physically. It's nice to have something like that installed in your car, because every other connection or every other switching element is built inside the box, or it is a closed thing and you can't to be sure without passive measurements if it's truly on or off. If you are breaking the line, if there is a physical gap inside the high voltage wires, then you can really make sure that the high voltage system is truly disconnected and your car is safe to work on. So I would suggest to design an HVD, which is clearly visible if it's installed or not, and easily accessible for everybody, and every team member is familiar with the principles and working behind the HVD. And last but not least, there is another master switch, the Tractive System Master Switch, which is there to finally power the accumulator installation relays. After that, or prior that, you can have your other interlocks. What I mean under other interlocks, every kind of high voltage connections have to have an interlock circuit wired with that. And what this interlock circuit is there to detect if there is any high voltage connector which is not connected, or if the high voltage line is broken on at any point. So, for example, if you have wheel hub motors in all of your four wheels, then it's really likely that you have high voltage at those motors as well. Then it means that you have to route an interlock circuit to every motor and make sure that the motor connectors are connected as well. And the motors are connected to the car, actually, because with wheel hub motors, it can happen that your wheel are broken down and you are going to lose a wheel. And if you have wheel outboard motors, then the high voltage cable will be left floating from the car, and having voltage on these broken cables is also a danger. And after that, you have your pre-charge circuit. So the pre-charge circuit is necessary because the inverter has a really high capacitance and you don't want to connect your battery without recharging the capacitors, because you will have a really high current and it will actually likely destroy your inverter and your electrical connections as well. And after that, you can have the accumulator insulator relay, and after that you may have any additional activation logic which you want to install your car. So these are the components of the most basic system of your car, what your car has to have from safety point of view. So make sure these systems are there and that they are working. And after that, you can continue with other things. I've broken up the car parts for three categories. The first red thing, the must-have, you really want to make sure these three things are present in your car and assembled well, documented well, manufactured well. If you are checking those points, high voltage battery monitoring system, by the way, EMS and BMS are similar terms. Right now, the rules are like to use the EMS term, but for historical reason, I'm usually saying battery management system, which is BMS, but don't be confused. These are basically the same thing. So the IMD, the installation monitoring device, oh, actually rotated it two times, but it's very important, so it's not an issue. You have to have Tractive System Active Light, which is also a self-made part, ready-to-drive sound, brake system plausibility device. You will have to have an accelerator pedal position sensor, because otherwise your car will not able to move. You also want to have a minimal driver HMI, human-machine interface, which are usually just a few buttons or LEDs at the first time in your cockpit, to make sure that you can switch off the accumulator insulation relay, you can set your car into ready-to-drive mode, and you also want something which are able to create the ready-to-drive sound. You also have to have a charger assembly on your event, because you want to charge your electrical car for sure, and there are safety and other regulations for the charger assembly as well, which is going to be checked during the event. Usually, if a team doesn't have a proper charger assembly, we are still letting them race, but we are not letting them charge. So if you are arriving to the event with a fully charged battery, but without a proper charger, you may have a few runs during the event, but if your battery is not oversized enough, that in that case you may not have enough charge to finish the endurance. Also, documentation is really, really important. I know that for electrical cars or electrical teams, it feels like that the electrical safety form is a really huge document, which is well, not that convenient to make when you are also have to build your car. But actually, the electrical safety form is an opportunity for you to create a comprehensive documentation of your electrical system of your car, and make sure that you have a clear understanding of the system, and these documents can be spread out within the team, and everybody can be familiar with that system. Also, it helps you to check that your design meets the regulations, because you have to write the documentation, have to go through again on your wall system. I actually recommending to start the electrical safety form writing when you are start designing the car, because the electrical safety form has a template, and if you are going through that template, it makes sure that you are don't forget anything designing to your system. But it's helpful. Well, telemetry is really, really nice, but if you have telemetry but an unreliable car, then you are not going to finish endurance. Also, it's very nice if you have a more complex driver interface with which your driver can set other variables within your system, but it's not mandatory to finish the endurance. And also, I would say regenerative braking is not a must have, but only a helpful thing, because I think for first year you usually will have a rear-wheel driven car, not a four-wheel driven car, and the energy you can regenerate with braking is not that much to have the risk that test out this function very well. So only aim for regenerative braking if everything from the must-have is already finished and done. And also the would be nice category, it's basically other extra strike, vehicle dynamics control, torque vectoring, yaw rate control, and other bells and whistles your car can have and may or may not make them faster, or make it faster. So, actually, this slide was before. So, a few critical system parts. I couldn't emphasize enough that the HV batteries are really, really dangerous thing. So, you can see the pictures on the right corner. The upright is a battery which burned down, and well, it can be a before and after picture, because this thing right here is this battery, believe or not, but if a battery catches fire, then you can make sure nobody, nothing is going to remain from that, or not, at least nothing usable. Also, I'm not sure if you have heard or not, but back in 2017 or 18, I'm not sure the exact year, but on former student Germany, one team wanted to maintain the battery with inside their hotel room, and there was a problem and the battery catched on fire, and this is what left from the hotel room after the battery fire. Andrei, do you have a question? Or?
No, no, I just remember this accident. It was in 2016.
16, okay, thank you.
I was living in the same hotel. I remember well.
Well, then for you, it is a really intense memory. So yeah, the main message is that don't be afraid from the high voltage system, but respect it. So
yeah,
it can lead to really, really serious things, and it's really not a joke. How can you avoid situations like that? Well, design it properly. So you have to have a CAD model which is as detailed as you can make it so. So design in every cell container, every mechanical fixing, every PCB, every last cable, every last connector. You have to make sure that your high voltage battery design is really talked through. And it's a really, really reliable package. Also, use PCBs for battery modules and so on as much as can, and avoid floating wires and wiring cell voltage measurements and so on. If you can know that you made a nice battery design if you open the box and don't see any wires. Just a clear surface or clear surfaces and PCBs and things like that. But you, if you have wires floating around in your accumulator cell compartment, then it's a sign that your design is not really good. Mm-hmm. Then after that, be sure to separate low voltage and high voltage parts. And this is true for the wall package, the wall high voltage card, that you have to make sure that the low voltage parts and the high voltage parts are not touching each other. And if you have PCBs and systems where are these systems are interfacing, then you have to be really careful that you are maintaining installation rules and so on. Also, I said on the PCBs, don't do any quick fix instead of remanufacture them, but in the high voltage battery, this is especially true. So you don't want to not finish endurance or catching your battery on fire because you get a loose wire inside your accumulator management system because you made some quick fix inside them instead of redo a PCB. And it can be actually one small jumper wire on your PCB, which causing that. In the first year, I not suggest to aim for a minimum weight, minimum sized battery, because with a package like that, you will more likely to have thermal issues, which also can be a problem. And yeah, reliability will be your main challenge, not minimum weight again. Also, wiring part. This is can be true for the wall card, but especially true in the battery. You want to use as many different cables as possible. So it's pretty straightforward for the high voltage cables. I suggest to use the same manufacturer, but different cross sections for different needs. And for the low voltage cables, I also suggesting the truth that select one manufacturer with the appropriate temperature and voltage isolation requirements and use those cables. I created two options with low voltage cables with high voltage installations. You are needing that inside the battery, but you are going to need other low voltage cables outside your car. If you don't have any kind of cost reasons, don't have to distinguish between these two, and you can use only high voltage insulated low voltage cables as well. But if you need to buy cheaper cables for the wiring harness, then you can use those as well. But make sure that you are don't mixing them up. Also, don't let any part of the battery left moving or left loose inside the package, even not a single wire, because you have to keep in mind that those wires have weight as well, and inside the car when it's running there will be a lot of shocks and a lot of vibrations, and within time these connections are going to get loose if the cables have to bear any kind of mechanical stress. And I would like to emphasize again, never use your car without a proper IMD and actually accumulator monitoring system. Self-made ECUs. Well, your car certainly will have self-made ECUs, self-manufactured, self-designed PCBs, and you have to make sure that these PCBs are designed correctly. From regulation point of view, the only important thing is separating high voltage and low voltage. And you have to keep in mind two things, creepage distance and clearance distance. These things are different. This picture is very nice because you can see that clearance is the shortest distance between two conducting part of the PCB. But actually I can zoom in a bit to make sure that you are seeing that. So clearance is the shortest distance between two conducting part of the PCB, and creepage is the shortest distance on the surface of the PCB within two conducting part of the PCB. On the rules, there is a table in which you can find the minimum required distances, both clearance and creepage, and you want to respect that. Also, a good way to check your installation is proper, then if you are going to light through the PCB, you have to see a clear barrier within the light. One thing that is an easy fail for the teams, that the rule says the minimum required distance for a certain voltage level is X and Y millimeters, but there is a footnote that if otherwise not specified by the component datasheet, and you will use these insulation amplifiers or insulation devices which are crossing the insulation border. And the pin distance in these components can be unusually smaller than required within the data sheet. And the trick is that if you are using these small SO8 packages, usually in the data sheet, the manufacturer states that the insulation requirement is only fulfilled if you apply some kind of special coating on your PCB. And this is the trick, that teams are usually not reading that part, and especially not treating the PCB with special coating. So to be safe and make sure that this is correct, I suggest to use the most wide packages in the installation device can come. So wide SO8 and things like that. Also, because of PCB manufacturing is cheap, maybe not fast from China and countries like that, but it is cheap. You have to make sure you have spare units from everything, maybe even populated PCBs and unpopulated PCBs, because you will need it on scrutineering. And if you have any kind of system failure, then you have to have an easy replacement. So manufacture multiple pieces of each component and also have multiple iteration runs and manufacture the PCBs until they are not completely ready without any external modifications. Wiring harness. Well, this picture not coming from a former student car because I haven't had a picture with a not properly routed former student car. And this picture comes from the BMA former student team Facebook page. And what the guys are doing and the girl is manufacturing the wiring harness with a really big on a really big piece of paper on they have in the design of the wiring harness. So you have to make sure your wiring harness is properly designed, and you want to make sure that every last crimp, every last mechanical connection inside your wiring harness is properly tested, because you will have like a lot of crimps and pins and things like that inside your wiring harness, and if one pin breaks down, then you are going to search for it for a very, very long time, and your car will maybe fail on endurance because of that. So you want to make sure in the first place that these things are correct and fine, and later on it will not cause any headache for you. Also, I haven't stated this before on the systems, but the battery, the accumulator management system, even the inverter usually are communicating on CAN communication lines. And you are certainly want to have CAN communication lines between your systems in your car. And I suggest to use multiple CAN buses within the car and separate the CAN buses from functions, or according to functions, sorry. Because you want to make sure that the most critical signals, like battery signals or inverter signals, accelerator position signal, are sharing one common CAN bus. Some inverters are requiring two CAN bus connections as well. So this is one or two CAN bus inside your system already. And the other things, the not must-have things, are have to be on a separate CAN bus, because if, for example, if your telemetry ECU failing, or your, I don't know what you want in your system, but other kind of self-made, not critical ECU is failing, then if this small ECU, which is responsible for, like, I don't know, DRS opening in your wing or something like that, drives the CAN bus into an error state, then your car will shut down certainly if this system is not on a separate bus. So make sure your CAN system is designed properly and the most critical components are having an own CAN bus inside the car. And lastly, scrutineering. One thing what you really want to keep in your mind, and this is scrutineering is not against you, it is for you. It's actually there to make sure your car is safe and your team and you and your car will survive the event without any kind of problems inside your car. If you are prepared, if you prepare for scrutineering at home and you are familiar with the checklist, then you are nothing to be afraid of. And if you are prepared properly, scrutineering can be a really quick and flowing process. Problems are starting to accumulate if you are arriving to the event with an unready car. So if you have to finish parts of the car to meet the regulations on the event side, then you will surely have a hard time on scrutineering. Also, just a quick hint that the scrutineers are not capable of testing everything in really, really high detail, but we are also looking for that your system knowledge and your confidence is there or not. So if you are proving us that you are familiar with the car, you are clearly understand the working, and you are clearly understand the safety risks behind that, the scrutineer will believe that your car is properly designed, and you are a proper person to operate the car. So keep that in mind and make sure that you are this kind of person who are understand the safety risks and capable of running the car smoothly and responsible enough to make the call if the car can go or not go on the event, and never ever compromise safety. Also, you don't want to be rude with the scrutineers, because these guys will decide if you can run on the event or not, and if you are giving them a hard time during the day, then they will give you a hard time as well. Not because they are rude, but this is the dynamics of interpersonal relationships that you are not willing to be nice with somebody who are not nice with you as well. So don't be rude, but be confident. And thank you for your attention. I'm looking forward to receive your questions.
Hello, David. Hello. Thanks for your time. It was very interesting and very useful for us.
Happy to hear that. Yeah. Thank you.
I want to apologize. We are currently in design process, and that's why I have a lot of questions to you. One from my guys is electric ME distortion on ACU, influence of ME distortion on ECU. Is it very important? Can it be or not?
Oh, so your question is how serious are the electromagnetic compatibility issues with the high voltage inverter and the motor and things like that, and the influence on other parts?
Yeah.
Well, you have to take it seriously, because in the inverter you are switching multiple tens or hundreds of volts and amperes with a really high frequency. So these high voltage cables you are using are usually coming with the shielding, and this shielding concept have to be properly designed, and you want to make sure that this shielding is grounded in one single point in your system. And after that, I think there is not much you can do. What is helpful, if you are not routing analog signals inside your wiring harness, but you are creating digital signals from analog measurement as close to the measurement happening as possible, and sending those values via digital signals on canvas. The two principles are going to cover that, I think.
Okay, thanks. And next question about, you said about tractive system wires, yeah? We have a lot of problems with financing, and we try to build our design more cheaply, and maybe you can advise us some life hacks or hints to make our design cheap, but still in terms of regulation and in terms of safety functionality, especially you said about orange shielded wires, but in rules, there are no strong requirements about this these expensive shielded orange wires. Yeah. Can we use some out or it's the
question of that? What the last part of the question, because there was a connection issue. Could you please repeat that?
Can we use cheaper serial wires, maybe in a rubber insulation, instead of shielded orange automotive wires?
I think the shielding is not recommended in the regulations, but as the aforementioned EMI issues, I think you want to use the shielding cables. And what I'm suggesting is the design, the wall package, the wall system, as you don't need that many meters of high voltage cables, so put the high voltage components as close together as you can, and try to save money within the length of the cable. And if you can afford, I suggest to buy the insulated cable. I know it's expensive, but if you cannot at the first, then yes, you may test with or may run the car with the cables meeting the insulation requirements and the temperature requirements, because those are in the regulations. But yes, the shielding is not necessary. So if you have to cut some cost on that, you can, but it may lead to EMI issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. And maybe the same question about fire retardant UL94 materials in structure of battery. Maybe you can
I'm not sure if the problem is on my end or on your end, but sometimes the connections are broken. And I can't understand the question because
the electric materials with UL94. Okay. I think there are connection problems. I try to repeat about the electric materials, this fire retardant functionality, sheet fiber glass or maybe some polycarbonate with fire retardant functionality.
To be honest, I can't recommend the exact materials about that. Teams are usually using materials like that, these fire resistant polycarbonates and carbon composite materials. And what we are looking for is a certification from the manufacturer that you are meeting those fire requirements. So if you have that kind of documentation for your material, then it will be accepted.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Next question. You said about important part of ECU is separate high voltage and low voltage.
Yes.
But part and we saw all our information through scan bus from BMS and inverters. Is it normal? Is it possible? I think I see no requirements in technical regulation for that.
I think the connection problem is on your notebook. On your exact computer you are speaking of, because the picture from the other camera is fine.
But maybe I'm wrong.
If I understood correctly the question, it was about the insulation properties of the accumulator management system and the inverter. Yes?
No, the same. It's about ECU design.
Yes.
Question about ECU design.
Now I completely lost your sound. Maybe you can write the question in the chat box and I can read it.
I'll try.
Yes, for battery management system, you can get those informations on Canvas, but there are certain parts which needs to be hardware designed, like accumulator, active light, and so on. So in that case, you have to interface the high voltage with your design. But for example, in the case of accumulator indicator light, then you are not have to face the low voltage system because the only requirement is to having a light which is lighting when the high voltage is present. So you can source that voltage from the high voltage. I'm thinking because, no, actually with your BMS design, you have to interface the high voltage and the low voltage surely. But if you are looking for like a Texas Instruments battery management chip or something like that, these are usually coming in a master slave configuration when you have several slave modules and you have an isolated digital communication line between them. So you have to have a main battery management board and you don't have to connect high voltage to this battery management board. You only have to connect the battery management system's digital communication. And therefore this separation is present by design.
About role of ACU in a pre-charge socket, for example. We have to measure voltage, yeah, and then we switch on a pre-charge socket and wait for voltage is rise, yeah. And then when voltage is about 95%, we switch on the second air isolation relay. And for this functionality, can we use only information from
It's actually a hard question. I have to check the rules.
BMS and inverter.
I have to check the rules to answer that properly. So don't take this for sure what I'm saying at the moment. But if you are switching off the pre-charge circuit and waiting to close the pre-charge circuit with a relay, the information from Canvas is, I think, okay, because it means that the Canvas is online and everything is fine. For the pre-charge, I think it's fine, but for the discharge, it is not. So if you have to allow the discharge circuit to be working from the Canvas, then it is an issue, because if your Canvas is down, then you are not having discharge functionality. And the pre-charge functionality is critical to have a proper system operation, but the discharge functionality is critical because of safety reasons. And these basic safety functionalities have to be covered with hardware solutions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll try to look at another question. You hear me? You hear me?
Right now, yes, but sometimes the connection is broken for a few seconds.
Okay. I'll try to ask. IPPS must have two sensors, yeah, and we want to use, and the requirement that if it's analog, they I think
I'm going to try to reconnect because I haven't heard the questions. It's kind of funny because I'm hearing if you are asked the connection is all right, but I'm not hearing the question. Could you try to switch off your video stream? And I think it will make the audio better.
Okay. Okay, one more time. Accelerator pedal position. Are you here? Is okay?
Yes,
okay.
I can hear you. Accelerator pedal position sensor.
Okay, thanks. There are requirements in technical regulation that there must be two sensors with different non-intersecting transmit function. Yeah, and we want to use the same throttle position sensor on one axle, and one sensor will be one curve from sensor will be a rise, and the second will be down. Is it normal for this regulation or not?
I have to see the characteristic curve, but from your explanation, I think it's right. Yes.
Okay, thanks. One interesting question about Tractive System Active Light. There's some requirement to measure voltage across DC capacitors in inverter. Yeah, and we will buy off-the-shelf inverter, and should we disassemble it or I'm wrong?
No. What this regulation means that your voltage measurement has to be outside from the accumulator, and on the HV system, the measurement point shall not be disconnectable from the inverter. So, mm-hmm. So if your system shutting down, you may separate the battery from the measurement point, but not the inverter.
Mm-hmm.
So okay. you always have to measure the DC connections of the inverter.
Okay, thank you. And one more. Maybe you can advise some advices about thermal battery thermal simulation or battery cooling. It's interesting question. How often things may make it to work normal?
If you are designing a battery which is really on the limit of finishing the endurance or not, then you have to have some simulations like that. If you're oversizing your battery with like 30% of some or something like that, then I think you are not going to have issues like that. But for battery temperature simulations, and the ANSYS softwares are good, and I've seen that software working, but I'm not an expert of that field.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and
what you can also do is ask for the cell manufacturer some MATLAB models or Simulink models for the cell, or ask for electrical circuit model equivalent parameters. And from MATLAB, you can actually simulate or calculate the temperature rise and or the thermal energy dissipation of the battery pack. And from mechanical engineering point of view or CFD design point of view, you can use that as an input. And this way you can separate the simulation into two parts.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. And two questions remains. Question about ACO qualification, electric system officer. He should have education to work with high voltage. So what certificates will be passed for scrutineering for this man, for you, what requirements?
Yes. It's very nice if you have this kind of certificate or diploma, but we are usually also approving bachelor degree of electrical engineering, and we are working on that rule because it's really hard to keep track what can we accept or not. So in the future, this regulation may change a bit to sign a paper that you are responsible for the car and you stated about yourself that you are capable of make those decisions and take those responsibilities with the high voltage system.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. And maybe last one about BSPD, brake system plausibility device. And I asked Christopher yesterday, Christopher Lemonmeyer, and I want to ask you about sharing current sensor of BSPD. Can this current sensor of BSPD can be used in different functionality or not?
Yes, it can be used for different functionality. One thing you have to make sure that on the scrutineering you have a way to disconnect the current sensor from the BSPD. So on the checklist there is a point we are required to test what happens if the BSPD doesn't receive a current signal. And you have to have a way to disconnect the current signal from the BSPD. If you can fulfill that, then you may use that current sensor for different purposes as well.
Mm-hmm. And about BSPD, one more thing. On scrutineering, we should show how BSPD works, and we should give to BSPD 5 kilowatt signal from current sensor. And what we should do, maybe you. So what instruments we should use for this? Maybe you can tell us about what variants of that will be.
Well, there are many different solutions for that. The most likely is usually have an analog current sensor, and you can simulate the output signal of the analog current sensor with a function generator or a laboratory power supply and something like that. So you disconnect the sensor.
Disconnect sensor, okay.
And you are connecting a laboratory power supply. This is one solution. One solution can be a function integrated into the PCB that you like switching a button or switching a switch, and the system is in simulation mode and you can prove that the voltage level is there to simulate the 5 kilowatts of power. Also, other thing can be done if it is a Hall effect sensor, then you may use a wire, wind it against the sensor many, many times, and with a power supply you can feed like 1 ampere, and if you wind 10 times this 1 ampere inside the current sensor, then you can measure 10 amps, and with this technique, the sensor also can be included inside the simulation, but yeah, there is many options to do that, so.
Okay, thanks. The question was about can we disconnect this BSPD current sensor or not? Maybe.
You can.
Thank you. I think for now it's all questions. Thanks for your answers. I hope this information and you will help us in building our electric car next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Happy to be able to help.
Hello.
Hello.
Так, suppose that it our battery, the power leads are in removable segment and pass through a hole in the container wall. Can we use such solution?
Sorry, could you repeat, because I'm not sure I understand correctly the question.
Suppose that in our battery, the power leads are in removable segment and pass through a hole in the container wall. Can we use such solution?
Power what? Lead or lead? Or?
Lead. Но они у нас установлены в съемном сегменте, проходят насквозь, ну, через отверстие стены с контейнером. Приемлемо? Нет.
Но как-то выглядит, да?
Ну да. Но просто у других, по-моему, они, ну, сам целый коннектор установлен на стенке. Ну,
he want to ask, he want to ask you about can we out our wires, our power wires, through walls of battery container. I think that's what he want to ask you. But I think we can because he ask can we go out from container with wires without connector or not. I think the question was.
I see. Okay, so with high voltage wires, you are not allowed to leave the battery container if there is no switching device present. So you have to be able to separate any wire which contains high voltage with insulation relays exiting the container. The connector itself, it's not a requirement. You can have other kind of solutions, but you have to have an accumulator insulation relay for every cable which are high voltage.
Thank you. We understand.
Thanks.
Okay, David, so it seems like there are no more questions so far. A big thank you to you. It was interesting, and I think it will be useful and help the teams. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you for the opportunity. And good luck for designing the electrical cars.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank
you very
much. Goodbye. So, bye, David. Bye. Hope to see you next year on the FS East.
Yeah. And hopefully in FS Russia as well.
We hope so.
Goodbye.
Bye.